So I went to this this movie yesterday with some friends, and they sort of talked me into it. I wasn't sure if I wanted to see it. It was actually a movie called The Apostle Paul. And you think, well, surely the preacher wants to go see that. But to be perfectly honest, I thought it might be, you know, a little churchy, and I wasn't sure how good it'd be. And it was awesome. If you get a chance to go see it, it was really incredible. And what they did was, honestly, I hadn't seen any of the trailers. I hadn't read anything about it. I just knew the movie was Paul the Apostle. And so what they'd done is they took about a week of Paul's life when he was in Rome, and sort of built off that, and the relationships that he had going on there, and how Luke was there with him, and Aquila and Priscilla were there, and how they, you know, worked together as a community and built relationships against all odds. You know, they had such a small community in Rome there, and they were really being oppressed by the Roman government, as you might imagine. And so what it would take to operate as a small group of people in a hostile world. And so I think they did a phenomenal job. I think they did a phenomenal job, too, of a sort of underscoring Paul's underlying message throughout all of his letters to the people in all the churches. One is he wanted them to know that because of God's love, they can be strong. And second, he wanted to make sure that above all else, they knew that being a Christian meant to love. To love when others didn't. To love when others were persecuting you. To love when others were killing you or whipping you or doing all manner of evil against you, falsely or not. Paul wanted them and us to know what true love meant. True love meant to be steadfast, to hold strong to God, to hold strong to others, and definitely to hold strong in the worst circumstances to our faith. On this Palm Sunday, we're reminded of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem to shouts of Hosanna. We were just reminded of that in this song sung by the choir. We're reminded by the palms that were waved as we were lighting the candles today and read the children's message to all of God's children. But we are also reminded that oftentimes the same voices that shout Hosanna can, with the mob mentality, turn around and shout, crucify, crucify. Have we ever done that? Have we done that ourselves when somebody that was important to us came and we shouted their praises, and then maybe they messed up a little bit, and then we turned around and crucified them? Jesus on the cross said, forgive. In the movie yesterday, Paul said, even when the circumstances don't call forgiveness, forgive. When somebody flogs you, forgive. When somebody hurts you, forgive. That's not an easy thing to do. Jesus called it picking up our cross and carrying it. This time when Jesus was here, this time when Paul was alive and traveling around, must have been an exciting time. Although it would have been a dangerous and troubling time as well. The Bible tells us of two different kinds of time. There is, at least in the Greek language, there is chronos time and kairos time. Now, chronos time is what we're probably most familiar with. Chronos time is 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock. At 12 o'clock, the pastor's supposed to be done speaking, right? So we can go to lunch. Kairos time is God's time. Kairos time is an eternal extension of our time. It goes beyond our boundaries. Time, chronos time, as we're used to, kind of frames up everything that we do. It gives us boundaries to work in. Kairos time takes away all those boundaries. In Kairos time, time is measured by love. Jesus's Kairos mission is Kairos time was at hand this week. He came in to shouts of Hosanna, and he was also met with shouts of crucifying. As he journeyed toward the cross and the ultimate proof of God's love. Now today we're going to have a little bit of a reading of Scripture. Not a little bit, it's going to be a big deal. Okay? And guess who gets to participate? Everybody!
At daybreak, the chief priests, with the elders, legal experts, and the whole Sanhedrin, formed a plan. They bound Jesus, led him away, and turned him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned them.
Are you the king of the Jews?
Well, that's what you say.
The chief priests were accusing him of many things.
Aren't you going to answer? What about all these accusations?
But Jesus gave no more answers, so that Pilate marveled. During the festival, Pilate released one prisoner to them, whomever they requested. A man named Barabbas was locked up with the rebels who had committed murder during an uprising. The crowd pushed forward and asked Pilate to release someone, as he regularly did.
Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
He knew that the chief priests had handed him over because of jealousy. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas to them instead.
Then what do you want me to do with the one you call king of the Jews?
Crucify him.
Why? What wrong has he done?
Crucify him.
Pilate wanted to satisfy the crowd, so he released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus whipped, then handed him over to be crucified.
The soldiers led Jesus away into the courtyard of the palace, known as the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole community of soldiers. They dressed him in a purple robe and twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on him. They saluted him.
Hey, King of the Jews!
Again and again, they struck his head with a stick. They spit on him and knelt before him to honor him. When they finished mocking him, they stripped him of the purple robe and put his own clothes back on him.
Then they led him out to crucify him. Simon, a man from Cyrene, Alexander and Rufus's father, was coming in from the countryside. They forced him to carry his cross.
They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means skull place. They tried to give him wine mixed with myrrh, but he didn't take it. They crucified him. They divided up his clothes, drawing lots for them to determine who would take what.
It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. The notice of the formal charge against him was written, "The King of the Jews." They crucified 2 outlaws with him, one on his right and one on his left.
People walking by insulted him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Ha! So you were going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, were you? Save yourself and come down from that cross.
In the same way, the chief priests were making fun of him among themselves, together with the legal experts.
He saved others, they said, but he can't save himself. Let the King of Israel, come down from the cross. Then we'll see and believe.
Even those who had been crucified with Jesus insulted him. From noon until 3 p.m, the whole earth was dark. At 3, Jesus cried out with a loud shout,
Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,
which means, my God, why have you left me? After hearing him, some standing there said,
Look, he's calling Elijah.
Someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, and put it on a pole. He offered it to Jesus to drink, saying, Let's see if Elijah will come to take him down. But Jesus let out a loud cry and died.
The curtain of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who stood facing Jesus saw how he died, he said,
This man was certainly God's son.
Even Jesus' final words were in Kairos time, not Chronos time. We think that it's in Chronos time, don't we, when we hear these words, my God, why have you forsaken me? We think that Jesus is crying out to God, why, God, have you deserted me? Why have you turned your face away from me? When Psalm 22 tells the whole story. These words are just the beginning of Psalm 22. Listen to how the story goes. I'm just going to go down Psalm 22, picking out certain verses to give you an idea of how this goes. In the first verse, he says, my God, why have you left me all alone? Why are you so far from saving me? So far from my anguished groans. And in verse 11, he says, Please don't be far from me because trouble is near and there's no one to help. But in verse 19, it says, But you, Lord, don't be far away. You are my strength. Come quick and help me. In verse 24, because he didn't despise or detest the suffering of the one who suffered, he didn't hide his face from me. God didn't hide his face from me when I was suffering. No, he listened when I cried out to him for help. And then in verse 27, it goes on to remind us that this story continues on today. Every part of the earth will remember and come back to the Lord. Every family among all the nations will worship you because of what the Lord has done. What at first seemed like words of despair were really words to remind the people that you may be saying, crucify him now, but I forgive you. You may be saying, crucify right now, but God's love will win in the end. Kairos time. In Chronos time. We're all reminded of Chronos time. Each year we get more chronologically gifted, don't we? As we have more and more birthdays, we know that those birthdays one day will end. But in Kairos time, we know that we will live forever. Through the grace of Jesus Christ, we know that we will enjoy God's eternal love because we live in Kairos time. What are the areas in your life where you're focusing on Chronos time and not on Kairos time? We all do it. We all rush around so much and forget the importance of stopping, of loving, of forgiving, of healing, of being God's agents of grace in the world, and stopping to enjoy God's grace at work in us. What if we lived? What if we lived on Kairos time? Each and every day, picking up our cross, please stand for the reading of God's word. As you are able. Jesus said to everyone, "All who want to come after me must say no to themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me." When we do that, we are on Kairos time. We are on God's time. And God uses us for God's purposes. Thanks be to God.